Hi. Morning, I think so. Yep. My name is Dan Kim. I'm here to talk about Git, a love story. This is mainly a talk like in terms of my like history with Git and sort of where I got started and where I am now and how much I sort of enjoyed that journey. All right, so I'll get started. I think I have the unique distinction of being the only presenter not to have an actual real picture in the slides or on the website. I am not an actual penguin. I just like penguins, so if you are disappointed that I'm not a penguin, that's kind of your fault, I think. I work at Nuna as a software engineer. At Nuna, we share a passion for improving the quality and cost of healthcare in America, and we're trying to work with industry decision makers to sort of answer the hard questions around how to use that sort of patient data to be more meaningful. Okay. So with any story, there's typically some sort of journey involved. Everyone starts at a different place. So coming out of college for me, I didn't have a whole lot of experience in Git. When I submitted assignments, it was mainly through a zip, and I emailed it to my TA. And that was quite a contrast because you typically, and depending on like the coursework that you work in, you generally don't need to use a version control system because you're doing all the coding typically. But as you sort of delve into that professional space, you start using IDEs and start working with other people. And so I guess my experience with Git to start out wasn't the best. Back in the day, I don't know if this is still the case, the default for IntelliJ was to force push any commits when you were committing through the IDE. I don't know how many of you know how problematic that is when two people do that, but basically there was the scenario where both of us would write the same release, and I would say that this is the correct version of code, and he would say, or she would say, that this is the correct version of code. And come release time, it made testing quite interesting, to say the least. But I did learn some stuff. Reflog is your friend. Typically, most things in Git can be reverted and are managed really well in the reflog that you can revert to things. And then anytime you force push, you should also always remember to do it with force push with release. So getting off to the on a better foot, I think that as you sort of grow and use more Git commands, the ones that you use more commonly will end up in your Git config. I wanted to share a couple different aliases that I like to use more frequently. This is one of my favorites, just getting off on the right foot, getting started quickly. It's go, which basically checks out the branch if it exists, and if it doesn't, it creates the branch for you. So just a little shortcut as a precursor to all of this. And as you're going through wherever journey you're going through, I think it's important to sort of, whether it's through commits or through pictures or through journaling, I think it's important to commit early and often. And I think that'll become evident in the next command that I'll go into. But sort of the pattern, for me at least, is that some commits have more meaningful messages. I'll want to add a command. Some commits are just, I'm going into a meeting, I kind of just want to push this code somewhere. And this is just what I feel like organically happens for me. Not every commit message is verb, whatever you're doing. I feel like life rarely works out that way. Like you don't always have the time to sort of do all the things, but I think it is important to sort of have checkpoints as you're committing. So, and that's why I kind of want to cover a little bit for Git bisect and how it works. So in this, I guess I'll step back one sec. So you'll kind of see that as I'm committing, I kind of identified that on the second to last commit with the hash of F4, I refactored some code, but I accidentally broke it in that step too. And I knew that the unit tests were working a couple commits down on E5 because I ran them before adding them. So those are the kind of commits that are kind of important for bisect, knowing the last sort of good commit when their code was in a good state. And typically, like, you just look at head, so that's the starting commit. So it'll go through that range and do like a binary search to determine where you sort of introduced the error. This becomes a lot easier if you use the run command and you sort of run the specific unit test that you broke to sort of identify which commit introduced that breakage. Okay, and so you fix the bug. Another one I really like is Git YOLO. This is very specific. It sometimes, like I use WIP work in progress commits a lot, but sometimes I just don't know what to write and I just do Git YOLO. And what that does is it just pulls a random commit message from that one website. And in this event, when I was recording, it said, this one was really hard, so. And then your code's done, right? Like, you fixed all the bugs, you've made it to the end of the story. And sort of that's kind of where most people just stop with coding, I feel like. And that's kind of why I want to dive into sort of part two. How are we doing? So the draft PR, the draft MR. If you've reviewed a lot of code, this is an example of probably one of the largest PRs that I've reviewed this year. You'll often see that this wonderfulness that says, diff is too large, cannot render. So depending on like how large your change set is, I think it becomes kind of more important that you have more meaningful commit history and you kind of split out the commits so that it becomes more reviewable, right? So, but I think before diving into that, I want to take a little step back at Git Graph. I think this was sort of demonstrated in the workshop, but this is sort of my variant on Git Graph where I like to see things in color. So this is what it sort of looks like. And for different projects and different teams, you'll adapt different patterns. For this repo, I believe it's Bazel. It seems like sort of the pattern that they're using is that they probably do an MR process or a PR process and they squash all of the code for that code into one commit and they don't have a merge commit. So that sort of varies. This is an example of a different project where it's kind of sort of somewhere in between. Some people do that sort of pattern where the first one, it's squashed into a single commit. But then other people in this repo, they'll have the commit, but they'll also have the merge commit. And then in other scenarios, they'll retain some of like history they have there and also have a merge commit. So different patterns for different teams. I think they're all valuable for different reasons and sort of the life cycle of the project and who you're working with. Sometimes it gets a little bit more complex when you don't have a release manager and people kind of just do whatever they want. And not all code gets merged back, so that's why like some branches just end up in nowhere. I guess subline merge. So this is sort of the pattern that I use when trying to like clean up the commit. So getting rid of all of the WIP commits, all the commits that don't really have valuable message or information, so that it makes sort of the PR or MR process easier for whoever's reviewing the code. So in this, I guess I don't know how visible it is, but you'll see that there's the initial where I have the branch, where I branched off of the feature. That's like the initial state. I have a bunch of WIP commits, and there's a commit where I said, oh, this feature, I finished this feature. And then sometimes you'll have to trigger the CI build or whatever, for whatever reason. None of these sort of commits sort of mean anything in the grand scheme of things, like the full diff. So, oh, I guess I'll say that you can use subline merge, but there's also integrated tooling with Git GUI, and I know that some people sort of do this sort of workflow on the command line too, so I know it's possible, but this is my preferred tool of choice. Because I like to be able to see sort of like the change set as a whole and sort of what I'm trying to tell you as a story for when you're reviewing the code. Is this the video? Yes. So you'll see that like I'm sort of staging different parts of the commit. So that first one, I'm sort of fixing a bug that was already in the code base. And then I'll sort of identify that I needed to add or update a dependency for whatever reason. And sort of I'll split that up into a different commit. And obviously this is a very simple example, but it can be expanded for larger, more complex use cases. But I think the point is that you're sort of chunking the code into more readable chunks so that I don't have to review 20,000 lines of code to understand sort of the core change that you're making. And oftentimes, too, when you're working on features, it very often you'll find yourself editing things that are sort of tangentially related, or you're fixing a different bug that sort of you just saw while you were there. But I think it's important to like sort of split that out, because at the end of the day, depending on sort of how large that change is or the complexity of that bug, it sort of makes more sense to review that separately than the work that you're currently working on. So after all of that, sort of we started on the left and then sort of ended up on the right. So the right is sort of like the linear story that you tell yourself, not necessarily that you tell yourself, but this is just how chronologically these events happened as you sort of worked through code, and everyone works differently. This is just how I work. But I think it's important to take the next step where you sort of make meaning out of this and sort of reorder things. So you'll see that how I organized it. I found the bug at the very end after integration testing, but I sort of moved it to the front. And there's various reasons to do that. It could be that you think that you might want to split that out into another PR, so it's just more manageable, or you kind of just want to, that's where you kind of want to just start your story. So that's where the storytelling process sort of starts. And this is like sort of how I would want to tell the story. I fixed a bug. I added a dependency for this feature. I worked on the main feature that is sort of outlined in the Jira ticket or whatever system that you have. And then I also worked on some other tangentially related things. So I think piecemeal, like it's important depending on the size of your PR to sort of make things better for whoever is going to be reviewing your code and outline things that you think are important. Because adding notes to a PR is great, but it's always nice to sort of just see that side by side if you're reviewing commit by commit. So when we get to the actual PR, so there's various patterns around this. This is not necessary to do if you sort of always, if your team always squashes into one commit. But if you sort of want to retain that history for certain files for whatever reason, so that you can do a git blame and sort of understand why a certain component of the code was changed, it's sort of valuable there. This is just a little quicker workflow where you can actually do git commit --fix up. And as people give you feedback, you can sort of align those change sets to whatever initial code that you were kind of working on. So in this scenario, this is sort of like the order I have, and this is like I get this one PR feedback where you need to change the dependency for a security vulnerability. So the fix up, you specify the commit hash, and it'll put the commit at the end, but what I'll go into a bit later where you can use something called auto squash, where it'll naturally pull the commit into the correct ordering that it needs to be for you to be able to squash it. So this is the alias I have for auto squash. It's a little bit fancier because it takes into account that not all repos, while they should be, renamed their master branch to main. It's not always the case, so it's doing a little bit of short circuitness there to determine the correct base of your branch. So that could be either master or head, or master or main, sorry. And so if you were to do a rebase without the auto squash feature, you'll see that there's the fix up message with the exclamation points, and then the commit message of the fix up you were trying to do. But if you did it with auto squash, it'll sort of label it as a fix up. So it'll use the prior message, so you don't have to redo that component. And it's just a faster workflow for this sort of scenario, if that makes sense. And so I think we kind of reached the end once your MR is kind of just, you've sort of cleaned everything up and you sort of squashed all the things that were extraneous as part of the PR process. And you're ready to merge back. And I guess the conclusion that I want to end up with is that Git is just, it's so much more than just the basic commands that everyone is probably more familiar with if you're only using it through an IDE, like pull, commit, and push. But there are so many other commands that you'll sort of pick up as you work more with Git. As you develop your workflow, you refine your workflow, you sort of get a better understanding of what your team cares about and how they leverage Git. Those I sort of outlined really quickly the ones that I use most frequently, and they could be different for you, but I think leveraging Git config and, again, making your workflow faster is very important. And then in the grand scheme of a story, there's the past, sort of the present, and the future. So the past is sort of how you experienced and how you wrote the code. That's basically before the MR. Presently, you kind of want to clean things up so that when someone's reviewing it, they sort of have a better experience. You don't have to work through, you don't have to go through 200 files to determine like what core change set you're trying to make. And then sort of the final product is when you merge back, there's also the concept of keeping those commits so that people can see historically why you made certain changes, regardless of whether it be part of the feature branch or not. So I think it's important to consider that the time you spend with code is not your own. People think that because code is, the end result is code, is that that's just the final product. But I think it's more than that. It's you want to tell a story. You want to share what you learned. I think that's best done if you take those extra steps to make the process better for everyone else. All right, that was it for me. I don't know if I'm supposed to take questions, but. Does anyone have a question? Oh. I didn't quite get everything you said. If you asked if you needed to force push.
Sorry, yes.
Yes, so. You do need to do a force push anytime you do a rewriting of history. So anytime you rebase and you change the actual commits, it requires a force push.
And correct. Is that generally kind of accepted? Like it's okay that you're force pushing into a pull request in that way?
Not during a pull request. So that's, from my personal perspective, you should not do that because depending on who reviews your code and how they review it, if you do a force push, it becomes more difficult for you to understand the specific change sets you requested. So this happens after the approval for me personally. Does that make sense?
Okay, yeah, because when you were describing rewriting, I assumed you meant for the person who was reviewing the pull request.
Yes. So there's like two or one or two stages where you rewrite history. And okay. they sort of happen differently, at least for me. All right, I'm happy to talk about the sort of the process that I use. Oh.
Is there somewhere that you posted your git config commands that we can look at?
Yes, I can make that available somehow. I'll try to coordinate with the event people to get that out there. All right, thank you very much.